and welcome to the Luv MEESH Podcast. I'm your host, Meesh, and it's a billion podcasts to listen to, and the universe guided you right here to this one. I've been podcasting for about 3 years now, so happy third birthday to me. I'm super excited to continue growing and sharing my journey with you. So welcome to my world. Hey, loves, and welcome to another episode of the Luv MEESH Podcast. On today's episode, we're going to be talking about trauma and the different types of trauma. And I wanted to do healing modalities first, but I figure some people will feel like, I don't have any trauma, I'm not traumatized, and from what I've learned, everybody has trauma. So I said, let me just do trauma first, and then we'll swoop back around to the modalities so that everybody can benefit. Because I didn't know, like, it's so many forms of trauma, it's ridiculous. And you will fit one category. That's how bad it is. Before we get into the topic, we're going to go over our recos. A business reco. The first reco that we're going to do is business reco. It's not a local business. They're just different businesses. But I want to shout out Indeed. Simply Hired, Aerotech, and even YouTube. I used to get on YouTube for music videos. And then it was free movies on there. And then I started looking into spirituality. And now I see it's TV shows on there. People talk about job. Anything that you need. Like, YouTube is definitely a university. So there's pages on there now that are telling you who's hiring. They're giving you the links. They're telling you how much they pay an hour. And I'm going to move from being off the phone. On the phone to off the phone, because I just can't anymore. It's just, I think I got 2 more months left. So I've been putting in applications. Shout out to my sister-in-law. She has just found a job that's not on the phone. So that gives me hope. There are jobs out there where I do not have to talk. And it's not the work. I can definitely do the work, but it's the people. It's the emotions, especially realizing that a lot of people are traumatized. People could be schizo or have all these mental illnesses and not know it, and you just have to deal with all types of people, and hurt people. So it's just like, okay, no, it's too much going on in the world right now. Everybody's emotions are high, and I just can't. And then shout out to my sister, because both of my sisters, I've seen them deliver food, deliver groceries. I mean, there's so many jobs out here. You don't have to be on the phone. So RIP to customer service, telephone customer service, because I'm counting down now. And it's real, because I had told my parents, I told my coworker. I was like, when y'all go back in the office, I'm not going to be there. So next month will be my last month. So I'm shocked, because I'm doing something. I'm leaving a job that I know is very stressful for me. But I'm stepping out on faith, because the income is amazing. But I choose myself and I choose my health. And I've just been praying to the universe. I've been praying with the rain, praying with the wind. I've been touching and agreeing with my sisters. Like, I have so much faith that the universe is going to pull me through. She's just testing me, and she's testing my faith. She's saying, you could talk about it, but are you going to be about it? So I'm going to be about it. And I'm just going to feel like more at peace. Like, I don't agree with the company that I work for anymore. But yet and still, I am accepting a paycheck. So I just want to be aligned, mind, body, soul, actions, with everything. I'm also going to look into some herbal places, since I like healing and stuff like that. But it'll come together. So shout out to the employment companies. So speaking of, let me just go ahead and skip to the joke. This is the laugh for today, right? We need to get one laugh a day. That's our prescriptions, right? More if you can. Why did the invisible man turn down the job offer? Because he couldn't see himself doing it. That was so funny. So shout out to Lewis House. He always sends emails. Oh my God, there's a bee. Everywhere I go, there's a bee. I hear you guys. She be reminding me that she is with me. Thank you for being with me. Confirmation. Ding, ding. Lewis House, he always sent email with these jokes in it. And I sent it to my mom, my grandma. They're so corny, but they're so funny. And I just love them. So, yeah, I felt like that matched. That matched the business reco. And I am going to do another podcast because there's this thing called the... is it the... Let me make sure I say it right. One... Okay, it's called The Great Resignation. Mm-hmm. Experts say that the Great Resignation may be here to stay. I want to light a board. Y'all know I'm on my spiritual boards. And it's not just me. A lot of people are saying that they love their job. They just want to be at peace. I just found out that I'm a highly sensitive person, extremely sensitive person, which means a lot of stuff affects me. I'm introvert. And I just need to find a job that matches all of that. For my peace, for my sanity, for my health. Like, I've been stressing about this job for a long time. And it was just like, yo, the job is, like, affecting you. So I'm going to come back around and do that. I think that would be an interesting podcast. So let me keep going. A video or movie TV reco would be Doctor Strange 2. I'm so excited. I looked on my little free app and it's not on there yet. Not on Disney Plus yet, so I might need to go to the movies this weekend. I'm gonna see if my sister or my daddy are go with me to see Doctor Strange. Like, I just cannot wait. I look at movies now and I see spiritual messages, I see clues, I see, I don't know, it's just like nothing is what it seems. And so now that I know what it seems, I just look at things differently now. So it's like, okay, maybe they can't get on the news and say, hey, do this, but they can put it in a movie, so to speak. So, I feel that there's yin and yang, good and bad everywhere. So the message will always reach the masses. It's just, are we listening? So, yeah, shout out if you saw Dr. Strange, too. I think it's called something else, but you know what I mean. A podcast reco would be, check out my YouTube trauma playlist. It's so many people talking about trauma is ridiculous. And I have learned that the planets give us energy that we think is chaos, that we think is scary, or we think you know, the devil's taking over. But a lot of the times trauma is a knock on your door that it's time to heal. Trauma pushes you to heal. It kind of pushes you against the wall where you have to fight. Like, okay, you haven't done this for how many years? Okay, I'm gonna put it into your face where you have to deal with it. Because otherwise, will we grow? So I kind of look at it that way. So check out the YouTube trauma playlist. One thing I like about YouTube, you could be cooking, you could be cleaning, you could just let it go. And your conscious, your subconscious, or your superconscious is going to pick up that information. And you might even have a dream about it, or it'll come back around to you as confirmation. So it's time to heal, y'all. Check out the trauma playlist. And so the Reiki healing prayer reco for this podcast would be... to all those who are hurting, whether you know it or not, and for those who have survived trauma or are still dealing with trauma, because some people are in a place where they can't leave, like kids and teenagers, there's nothing they can do about their trauma situations until they're old enough. And just imagine how difficult that may be. But there are dualities, so we don't want to always focus on the bad. I also want to send the Reiki healing prayer reco out to the healers, to the, whether it's a doctor or a pastor or a Reiki master, because, you know, we want to thank you. It's you that have gone through the trauma yourself, that have healed yourself, and you're reaching back and you're helping others. So there's trauma victims, and then there's healers. And being a healer is an archetype. It's a path, it's a spiritual path in this life. Well, I feel like we all have trauma, that you can choose to live this life so many different ways. I think some of us choose to heal from our trauma in whatever creative way we like, and then share that with the world, so, and heal others. I think that's just beautiful. It's like God gave you life, and so much shit was thrown at you. You overcame the shit, and God gave you a special gift. You use that special gift to overcome that crap, and then you bless the world. I don't know. I think it's just beautiful. Okay, and then our music record would be Kendrick Lamar, Mother. I Sober. I cried when I heard this song. And it just confirms that, it was like confirmation for me that I'm on the right path. Like, I get a lot of synchronicities. And it's like, okay, you're on the right path. It's like, I know, but I need that reassurance, like I've said before. And it's like, I'm not the only one going through this. So many other people are. And it's just not talked about. So I find therapy in this podcast because I'm usually the one that will listen to someone and have so much advice. It just comes from my heart. It comes from God. But I'll sit in silence with my own crap. And, you know, just not speaking up for myself. And when you find your voice, it's just such a freeing, beautiful thing. And so many YouTubers that I know, so many podcasts, so many blogs, it's like we found our voice. We found our audience. We found a safe place to share. So I do want to thank you for giving me this safe space to do that. That's beautiful. Where I don't have to fear my thoughts or the way I think, my religious views, what I'm learning. It's just like my little safe haven in the world. So I thank you for sharing that with me. So check out Kendrick Lamar, Mother. I literally cried. You know, I'm going to pray for him because I feel like a little nipsy coming on. Like, I feel like they're going to take him out. If anyone becomes powerful in a positive aspect, they're going to get them out because they're raising the frequency the wrong way. Have you noticed that you could talk about rape and killing and murder and all the negative stuff, and it's never censored on any social media, on any news, anywhere? It can go viral. But the moment you talk about healing, like doctors, they'd be dead. The moment you talk about getting your money together and building up the community, Nipsey Hussle.
Y'all heard of me?
Nipsey Hussle dead. It's like, I don't know. I just find that so.
I'm trying to do my podcast.
I just find it so, like, odd. Like, there's an opposing force. Like, it's literally a war. But the war's weird. I feel like one party is fighting back, like killing, so to speak. And the other party is fighting back with like knowledge and information and love. So it's not like a fair fight. And it really bothers me, but it's okay. So I'm going to let you hear a clip of Mother.
In Chicago, I'm sympathetic. Told me that she feared it happened to me for my protection. Though it never happened, she wouldn't agree. Now I'm affected. 20 years later, trauma has resurfaced, amplified. As I write this song, I shiver cause I'm nervous. I was 5, questioning myself, long for many years. Nothing's wrong, just results on how them questions made me feel. I made it home, 7 years of tour, chasing manhood, but Whitney's gone. By the time you hear this song, she did all she could. All those women gave me superpowers, what I thought I lacked. I pray our children don't inherit me and feel inside track on conversation not being addressed in black families. The devastation haunting generations and humanity. They raped our mothers, then they raped our sisters, then they made us watch, then made us rape each other. Psychotic torture between our lives. We ain't recovered, still living as victims in the public eyes. Who pledge allegiance? Every other brother has been compromised. I know the secrets. Every other rapper sexually abused. I see them daily burying their pain in chains and tattooed, so listen close. Before you start to pass judgment on how we move, learn how we cope. Whenever his uncle had to walk him from school, his anger grows deep in misogyny. This is post-traumatic, black families and a side of me. Today is still active, so I set free myself from all the guilt that I thought I made. So I set free my mother, all the hurt that she titled shame. So I set free my cousin, chaotic, for my mother's pain. I hope Hakeem made you proud, cause you ain't die in vain. So I set free the power of Whitney, may she heal us all. So I set free our children, make a karma, keep them with God. So I set free the hearts filled with hatred, keep our bodies sacred, as I set free all your abusers. This is transformation.
I have a link below on YouTube, and I've been seeing a lot of strange cars drive by. Because I've been looking at X-Files too, you know, I'm on my conspiracy shit. And every time Mulder finds something, like the hotel room will get burnt down or somebody will steal the car, it's just like he ends up being one place he have to leave. When he come back, all of his evidence is gone. And it's like a government inside of a government inside of a government. And it's like, how do you wake people up with facts that they've never heard before? Because all they know are lies. It's just so hard. Like, if someone were to say the sky's pink, that would be so hard to convince, because you've been told it is blue for so long. And I get it, but it's like, I don't know. It's just so weird. That I just feel like, I think at the end of the day, we're so powerful, we don't even know ourselves. Like, this opposing force is fighting us, and it's sad because we don't even know who we are. I think that's the best way I can say it. It's sad because we don't even know how special, how powerful we are. Because if we weren't, what would be the point of chemtrails and GMOs and fluoride and what, you know what I mean? Like, what would be the point? Hey, Mr. Sun. Okay, so the spirit teacher mentor guide for this podcast will be Dr. Diane Lambert. She did a YouTube podcast, or she did a YouTube video on chronic PTSD. And I have a link below, and I'm going to let you hear a clip of her. And I'm glad, and this is how universe works for me. I was already doing the podcast kind of start with me. So I'm already dealing with trauma for myself. So I started to look at trauma, and I'm like, oh my God, I have so much trauma to work through. Like, I literally was thinking military, or I knew that losing kids was one, but I didn't know relationships fell into that category, and trauma bonding and abandonment. I mean, it's just so much. I was just like, oh my God, I have so much to unpack. But so it starts with me, and then as I'm writing it in my journal, as I'm working through it, I like to just share, because I know if I'm going through it, someone else out there is too, and then we both can benefit and let our journeys go down different paths if they need to. But once I drop the information, whatever you do with it is up to you. But one person was saying, everybody doesn't have trauma. Oh my God, trauma does not exist. So when I saw her say chronic PTSD, chronic trauma, I was like, oh my God, that makes sense. There's always degrees of everything. You know, you can have a fan and cool you down. That's one form of being cool. You can turn on the air. That's another form of being cool. You can go to Greenland and be cold. You know what I mean? Antarctica. So they're all cold. It's just different degrees of cold. So I feel like I get what the people were saying when they were saying, like, everybody doesn't have trauma, like, grow up. I get what they're trying to say. It's someone that was raped every single day for 12 years. That's going to be completely different for me, maybe losing a child. It's not something that I dealt with every day, but that doesn't mean it's not chronic to both of us, because we are different individuals that have different levels of that we can bear. Just put it that way. So I just want to hold space and, you know, leave room for everybody. I mean, trauma is trauma. The shit hurts. I don't care what level it's on, and you have to heal from it. You have to acknowledge it. I think acknowledgement is the first step. Like, whoa, bitch, this is a problem. Like, we need to research this. We need to do it. We need to work with it so that we can get it out of our body, get it out of our emotions, get it out of our auras, cry it out, get a massage, you know, get some reiki, whatever modality you choose. But it all starts with facing it. So shadow work really was part one for me, like writing it down. And then I started noticing the name. You have to give it a name, like it's the different forms of trauma. And then it affects your body. So what ailments or what parts of your body is it affecting? And then that could have holes in your aura, which could affect your ability to manifest and different things like that, which can block your elevation. It's just, I fell in love with chakras, and I told my sister, because everything, all of my passions, all of my gifts to the world fall into the chakra categories, and I was sharing that with her. And I think I get frustrated at times because you have to balance this spiritual world and this earth world where it's like work, pay your bills, blah, 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 blah. But at the end of the day, you're going to die and you can't take any of this shit with you. So why was our focus 100% on that when it's our soul, it's the work that we did with our soul that's going to guide us there? What if you get on a dimension and you need to know how to get out that shit? You don't know nothing about your chakras. You don't know nothing about light energy. You don't know nothing about protection spells, evil eye, incantations. Like, you just going to be lost and come back to this bitch. So spirituality is more important to me. But I can't just go into a cave and focus on spirituality. I have to balance this shit. And that's the part that I'm at. It's just, like, so frustrating. Like, I don't want to human. I don't want to adult. I just want to focus 100% on spirituality. But that reminds me of one of my favorite. This one girl's like one of her favorite books. And her husband, Nagad, from my last episode, they were saying the Four Agreements and the Alchemist. Four Agreements, you know, I get it. I'm used to commandments or two laws of Maya. And yeah, like, it's rules are kind of like, because I'm such a rebel. But when it was probably still rules in the Alchemist, but when you put it in story format, I absorb it better. And so when I do finish with all of this, I'm going to put it in my Roses and Thorns book in a story format. So it's going to kind of be like the Alchemist, but it's going to be my version of my life and my traumas and the modalities that I found helped me heal. And I think that would be so beautiful. That's going to be the adult version, and then I want to turn them into little children books. And if that's something you want to do, go ahead. It's so many people out here to reach. I can't reach everybody, and you may do it differently. So I don't really believe in stealing. Put your sauce on it, put your energy on it, put your aura on it, whatever, and it'll go where it'll go, because the children really are the future. But when I think of the Alchemist, my one of the parts that just stick out to me, which I know that's mother reminding me, a king was telling him to put oil on his spoon and go look at the palace, but he dropped it the first time. When he came back, he said, oh, you missed a beautiful palace, try it again. And this time he looked at the oil so he wouldn't spill it as he walked around the palace. But he asked him, did you see the palace? He was like, no. He was like, oh, try again, go look at the palace. So the second time he looked at the palace, but he did not remember the oil, and he dropped the oil. So when he came back, he was like, that's your answer. That's how I am. He could have given him the answer, but he actually had to do it. It's the experience for me, and I hate it sometimes because experience so far has been painful. So I've asked God, like, please give me loving experiences, because I don't think I can handle the hurtful experiences anymore. Although I learn, and I thank my teachers for teaching me, but I have not handled the emotions yet. So oh my God, I'm so surprised. So where was I? It's reminding me to hold on to my spirituality and don't lose it, don't drop it like the oil, but also enjoy this beautiful world. So I am trying to find that perfect balance, which is so funny because I'm a Libra. Libra means balance. everything is a mirror for me. But or I'm starting to see the reflections, put it that way. So I'm going to push pause and let you hear Dr. Diane Lamberg. And I'm so thankful that just somebody that I follow had posted her. Like, I don't even be finding this stuff. Like, if we just keep sharing, it's going to get where it needs to be, because I needed to hear that. And she was just, I don't know, she's just a wonderful teacher, and she is Christian, so I was able to hear, you know, some Christian insights on it. But I don't care what your religious background is knowledge. I could take what resonates with me and leave the rest. And that was a beautiful YouTube video, so check it out. So I'm gonna push pause and let you hear a little clip and then come back.
to talk about something known as complex trauma. I'm assuming everybody in the room has heard of post-traumatic stress disorder. Yes? It seems to be in the news and in professional literature a great deal in the last few years. In part because there have been a lot of wars. And historically, when somebody has gone through trauma and has symptoms of being traumatized, they have been diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder. But there's been a shift in the psychological world in the last few years because we have come to understand that there are people who suffer from a different sort of trauma that is much more complex and is not under post-traumatic stress disorder. The definition of that disorder does not cover what those experiences are. Complex psychological trauma involves multiple repetitive chronic stressors. So it's not an event. You know, you can have PTSD from a car accident, from an incident in a war, from gun violence on a street, from all kinds of things. But complex trauma comes when somebody is repeatedly, chronically exposed to traumatic events over years. It usually involves harm from those people in their lives who should have been caregivers. So the ones who were to care for are the ones actually doing the traumatizing. It often occurs at developmentally vulnerable times, and we'll talk more about that. And so it has a tremendous potential to severely compromise human development. So what that means is that you can have a client or patient come in to see you, or you can have somebody in your church or whatever ministry you have who appears to be one way, but is actually profoundly compromised internally because of this kind of chronic over the lifespan traumatizing. So one of the things we found out is that in complex and traumatic stressors, they are generally interpersonal. You know, you can get traumatized by a tsunami, but when you have been traumatized by your own father, it's a whole different thing. They are premeditated.
Okay, so a book or good read record would be 30 articles that bring you through a fascinating journey of discovery about your origins, your true nature, and the coming new age. I have a link below, but it's kitchenwrap.blogspot.com. I don't think I would turn down anything. I haven't started on my dark magic yet, but the furthest that I've gotten is, I guess some people would say witchcraft is bad. So I took a witch class. I got some witch books. And they're more on spells and manifestation, so it might be on the white witch side. But I haven't, learned, like, more voodoo, dark stuff, curses and anything like that. Although I am. Just haven't got on that end yet. But I came across the 72 demons as well as the 72 angels. And I have my 72 angel card. They're in storage right now. But what Miss Deborah Dean was explaining is that the 72 demons and the 72 angels match, and they're all inside of us. Now, I was telling y'all about that chakra class that's $500. He was talking about the 72,000, whatever, and equaling $144,000. I feel like at the end of the day, he's gonna break that thing down into the 72 angels and the 72 demons and how they're inside of us. And I feel like it relates to, like, our organs, our body parts, our systems, from the eyes to the toes to the hair. Everything is pointing back to this body, y'all. It's more than a body. It's like a spaceship. It's like a soul ship. It's like our focus. When they say go in, inward, that's where the focus should be. But I don't know. I just thought that was interesting. So the closest that I've got so far was the angels and the demons. That's on YouTube too. And I think one man, he was about to call him in. I was like, oh, this is where I push pause. Because they was doing prayers and stuff. To like, he was like, you may want to do this outside. Because, you know, you don't want to do this while you're in the house. I'm like, oh, hell. I push pause. Like, I ain't ready for that. But it's not a fear thing. Because I remember I got so mad at this one lady for calling me, she called me an idiot or ignorant, and I know where that stemmed from. When I was younger, because I could be ditzy about some things, but I'm very smart. So things that people may get, it went over my head, but things that people didn't get, I got complete, you know, a complete understanding. So it's a trauma, let me just put it that way, that I have to deal with. And be careful what you say to kids, because they remember, and that manifests into something in them that they have to battle. It becomes a demon that they have to battle growing up. So, but anyways, hurt people, forgiveness is amazing. And you just have to, what I've learned on this journey is, if someone hurt you, you have to turn into that person and just give yourself the love that they didn't. That's basically what it boils down to. If you didn't have a good mother, you have to mother yourself. You know what I mean? If your friends weren't good to you, then you have to be your own damn best friend. So that's what a lot of this is turning into, because it's not like you can force them to do better. That's like it's really a mental heart, mind, body, soul thing. So just telling them, they have to put in the work and grow and evolve. So it's not going to work as easy as you think. So that's why it's best to just focus on you and make sure you aren't running around here hurting people. I don't know where I was going with that. But so check out this 30 articles. I was reading it, and I believe like a lot of different cultures and different things. Did y'all hear that bee every time? And they're talking about why we came to the planet, and I just was into the YouTube videos and the articles, and I just wanted to share it with you guys. Now, as I'm learning some stuff, I say, that might not be true. This may be true. Da, da, da. Like how they say, you know, Jesus, God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost. That never really sat with me, and I don't know why. It's not that I didn't love God, but when I heard, you know, God is a woman, that really sat with me. Like, women give birth to kids. I can see the woman giving birth to a son. And when you go and really look, just go look up the Black Madonna. A lot of people, even the Pope, worship the Black Madonna. It was a virgin mother that gave birth to her child. And I feel like that's how the story should go. But because men want to rule, can you imagine being on the news? Women, oh God is woman. Women rule the world. This thing would flip back right how it's supposed to be, and they don't want that. Like, I feel like men are so egotistical. Can you imagine learning that this whole shit is only working because of woman? And just think of it. It's the woman that goes to work, that cooks, that feeds the baby, that teaches the baby, cleans the house, prays for the house, like, and the man just what goes to work and bring home a check. It's like, who's doing the most work? That's the powerful being to me. She's able to and keep her mind most times until too many of them try to tear her down, you know. So just take whatever resonates with you. But so I'm gonna read through it, because I just think it's so interesting. And sometimes when you read stuff, you may take things out that you don't resonate with, which is fine. But just keep the stuff that do, because you may miss one thing. You may put down 10 and pick up one, and that one could be important. So check out that particular article. So the quote for this podcast would be, if trauma can be passed down through generations, then so can healing. I actually put this as a comment on Kendrick Lamar's YouTube for that song. And I saw this quote, and I thought that was amazing. Like, they don't really tell us the truth about our DNA. It's more than food and if you're fat or skinny. Like, did you know, with our culture being enslaved, that's called generational trauma, and it's passed down through your DNA, not because of the movies that you saw. Like, yeah, that's deep. And then I have a link to the podcast references. I'm going to read Quora, as well as my Pinterest link. So those are below. All right. Now let's get to the good part. So, this is the question. Is it true that everyone has trauma? What is your opinion? What are your thoughts? How do you feel? What is your point of view? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Ponder that, right? My answer is yes. I already explained it earlier. I just feel like we all have different degrees. And instead of arguing about you have more trauma than me, let's just accept the fact that everybody is hurt in some aspects. And maybe therapy was frowned upon, but I'm excited that therapy, I'm seeing a therapist, I talked to my therapist, that's like a thing now, and people are healing and recognizing that, I'm flawed too, or I could have hurt someone myself, or this person hurt me, and just learning to heal. Oh my God, did y'all hear it? Healing those aspects and just being a better version of you, right? What is the message? I hear you. I swear, I'm a queen bee, y'all. The bee tree is way on the other side of the yard. Oh, you know what? Her rose garden over here. But they're about dead. It's only one little rose. One thing the garden has taught me too, they will bloom and then that's it. Like my mom says, about 2 more months and they're about to shut it down. So you got to get that food while it's good, because the weather gonna change and that's it. And I think our bodies are the same way. I think there's a time when we're supposed to be putting a business out. It's a time we're supposed to be planning. It's a time, da, da, da. Like, there's seasons for us too. But we won't really know that, because what they got us doing, working year round, that's not how it's supposed to go. You need to rest, reset, get your mind together, spend time with your family, all that good stuff. But hey, it's the world we live in. I usually don't be hot, but your girl is sweating. I am sweating. And them little gnats be out now, and they be biting. I ain't with that. I ain't with the biting. I am not with the biting. See how I feel out here. I can sit in the heat. I cannot stand being cold. When my nieces used to, I'm trying to backyard, y'all. When my nieces, them, used to come over, they used to say my house was hot, like the desert. But anytime I let somebody here feel my hands, they're freezing cold. So, I don't know. I'm a sun child for sure. I was telling my sister I'm finna start manifesting and praying to the sun. Because I just found out that the moon is a satellite. And it's draining us of our fucking energy. So, no, I'm not finna praise the damn moon. Guess what? I was doing the, I was looking at Nagat, catching up on her videos. Because she was gone for a minute, you know, loving her family and husband. I get it. And I was like, girl, you need to come back. We miss you. So I'm happy she's back. I'll be having my little YouTube family. Girl, to my girl. It could be guys listening. Sorry. Her husband got a two-bedroom home on 5 acres. They're about to start a garden. Her son is vegan. It's like, when I see stuff like that, it's like, okay, I'm not crazy. I'm not alone. She knows that this stuff is healthy for her child. They know that they can grow their food and be self-sufficient. Just like, I may be in the wrong community, but I'm not alone. I'm doing the right thing. It just feels like I'm alone. So just, again, confirmation. What I have to figure out what trauma that is. Confirmation is just everything to me. But I was looking at her videos, and I think I looked up one time, and I didn't see nothing. So I started back looking at the darn videos again, and lo and behold, a black snake. And it wasn't a little snake. It was a big snake. And I was like, daddy. Then I was like, oh no. Then I didn't want to say it, because I'm like, they're going to kill it. And I was like, it's black snake poisonous. But then I don't want my mom to like have a heart attack or something like that. So he tried to like throw a brick at it and kill it with a shovel. But I think it got away. So I looked it up. What is the spiritual meaning of a black snake? And it means that I am facing my traumas and I'm elevating. So that was just confirmation for me. And that's what I mean when I be telling y'all I be getting confirmation. So I'm already researching trauma. I'm already journaling in my shadow work book. I just happened to share it on my YouTube, on my podcast as well. And then I be getting like little confirmations like that. That reminds me like, yep, you're on the right path. So we don't necessarily have a roadmap, because you make your own map. But I promise, if you just look around, there's confirmations. Which reminds me, there's warnings too. And usually it'd be my stomach. Like, girl, you don't need to do that. And I do it anyway, every fucking time. But we've been on a roll now. And if you try to do something and it doesn't work out, that could be a sign too, that you don't need to do that. So, I see you, universe. Thank you for the block. So let's get into this. Quora. I don't know how to say it. Quora.com. I don't know. Is it true that everyone has trauma? What are your thoughts? Okay, you heard mine. So let's hear some other people's opinions. One person said, I don't know. It is possible, but I really don't know. Some people are more resilient than others simply because they are supported when they really need it. So when something horrible happens, this person doesn't feel abandoned or alone. They understand they were treated abominably and that this is not acceptable. No one should be physically, emotionally, or sexually abused. But men, women, and children of all ages, genders, and races are abused. The truth of this is ugly and painful. No one experiences their trauma in the same way. It really depends on a lot of factors. Does the justice system support the abuse survivor or the perpetrator? Is the family supportive? Does the person feel like they deserve to be treated terribly? I did. Every single time someone treated me poorly, I thought, this is just what I deserve. This is okay. This is fine. It's not as bad as what my mom went through or my aunt or all the other survivors that I know. I don't matter as much as they do, or do I? I don't know. I'm trying to challenge my ingrained beliefs. What if I didn't deserve every bad thing that ever happened to me? What does that mean to my life? Why don't I think I deserve joy or meaning or purpose? What could my life be like without this gritted teeth experience? Forcing myself through everything, to drink, to eat, to be kind to myself, to be social, to do more at home, to do more for my cats, to do more in my house, to do more chores, to be more active, to help other people, to be a productive human being instead of a worthless nothing. To find some way to make money so I am not a drain on the system. To find out how I can work and not want to commit suicide and look after my shit without anyone having to worry about me. God, I so relate. And on and on and on. I am so sick of being like this. So I keep going to therapy and working on this. Does everyone experience trauma? Probably. Does everyone want to die and be tortured as if that would produce some kind of good sacrifice karma? I don't want karma to reward me. I want any good I put out to help others. Every single person that doesn't have the support of their family or friends. Just one thing so I can live peacefully by a lake and forest animals or something like this. I don't know. Something rewarding that I will enjoy doing. Something that will pay the bills. I completely agree with her. Because a lot of jobs will kill you. Like, if you look up the statistics of people having heart attacks and dying and stuff, it's from their fucking jobs. It's for their fucking jobs. So, if you want to be honest, insurance should be fucking free. Bitch, you're killing these people. But they don't want to talk about that. They want to give you 12 hours of FMLA and never talk about it. What forms you need, how to fill it out, or nothing. It's just there and it's just in the handbook. And you notice when you start a job, they don't go over that. They just tell you, call the EAP helpline. Nah, nigga, break that shit down. Break that shit all the way down. But anyways, I really resonate with her. Thank you so much for writing this post, PTSD World, Julie Penner. And she put unemployed student life. I really enjoyed your post. God, I really love your post. Like, I just relate so much. And again, it's the confirmation. It'd be the confirmation for me. This is someone else's. Damn, this person have. So check this out. She had 158 answers, right? This next person had 4.1 million answers. Damn, let's read that. Ann Clark, who lives in London, said, no, that's just not true. Most people do not suffer trauma. To experience life's normal ups and downs is not trauma. A minority experienced trauma. An ignored, neglected, abused child has trauma. A loved, supported child that experiences the odd row, death of a grandparent, or squabbles with their siblings is not on par with a truly traumatized child. Let's keep it real. I feel her trauma. Baby girl went through something. Because she is not relating with people with less trauma. She's felt like life has given her too much trauma and she's over it, the shits. And this is how your intuition kicks in. When they say a person tells of themselves by how they dress, by how they look, by what they say, especially what they say, you could just read. You could read through them. So now I see this is how I'm pretty sure a lot of therapists are intuitive because they can read more than what the person is actually saying. Because I just read more into her. That said a lot. The next person, and I don't agree with her, a love-supported child that has a death. This is my point of view. If your life has been perfect, right? Nothing bad ever happened and one bad thing happens, like a death, it's going to shatter your world because you've never experienced it before. It's going to be worse on you than the person that ate noodles, that ate mayonnaise sandwiches, that lights was off, that never got school clothes. Like, they know, you know, like, that's nothing. So they did with it so much. It's, when someone dies, they'll probably be like, someone died. Compared to this person had everything perfect in life and then all of a sudden, bam. You know, I hate to say it. Like, yes, they had an amazing life, but I'm not going to take that trauma away from them. It's just, that's just my point of view. Because the next person. Next person said, no, watching a car accident sucks. I have seen several. It's not traumatic. Your heart beats and you see terrible things, but you are fine. No one is trying to hurt you. You can walk away from the accident. You can feel for those in the accident and hope for the best, but no one is forcing anything on you. Be a child, have an adult make all choices for you and deny your innocence and freedom. Have the adult continually put you in painful situations you have no control over and tell you that it's your fault. No, I will repeat that. No, not everyone has trauma. So I feel like she feels like she understands this. So I'm pretty sure she's gone through this. And again, she's speaking through the trauma. Being raped every day by someone who's telling you it's your fault, knowing good and fucking well you're supposed to be the provider, you're supposed to protect me, and this is not what you're supposed to be doing. Your ass need to be under goddamn jail. It's kind of, I feel all that energy. It has nothing to do with somebody getting in an accident. Like, I hope you guys are okay. You can live to see another day. But I have to go home every night and experience God knows what. I get her point of view, but that doesn't mean she's right. She's just speaking from her point of view. She's saying, from the amount of trauma that I've experienced, that car accident is nothing. But again, for that other person, that may have changed their whole world. They may have lost their legs. Oh, traumatic. You get what I'm saying? A whole new life they got to live. So I think sometimes we get so wrapped up in our trauma that we are insensitive to other people. And that could be ego. That could be selfish. That could be forget you, but what about me? You know? And I don't think that's... I think you can say, damn, I went through a lot of fucking shit. And so have you. I think it's okay to say that. My trauma doesn't outweigh yours. Yours doesn't outweigh ours. We some fucking survivors. I think it's okay to say that. Like, why do we have to make something seem lesser? Why do we have to compare? Why does it have to be... I don't know. What I'm trying to say is everybody has been traumatized. And depending on your level of pain, like some women having a baby and say, oh, that was nothing. Some people have a baby and say, oh my God, I died. Some people get tattoos and say, that's nothing. Me, I got a little ass J. I got 3 tattoos and tattoo artists are murderers. They kill you and they resuscitate you and say, look at your tattoo. It was just painful for me, but that, because I know I'm sensitive, that's my gift. My gift is in my feel. So every tattoo that I get, I'm going to really feel it because I'm just so, I can feel every piece of, I'm just in tune with all of my skin, put it that way. Even to my nails, like, I don't know, it's ridiculous. Which is why I'm learning Reiki, because I know that's where what my power is. But that's just, it's just called pain tolerance. It doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt. Somebody can't tell me it doesn't hurt, it does. It's just your pain tolerance is high. And I can't tell that person it doesn't hurt. It does hurt because they have a high tolerance. We just have to accept the fact that a tattoo has pain, but depending on your pain tolerance, it may or may not hurt you because the common denominator is you. Okay, so I hope she's okay. You can feel. When I read, I'm glad I was able to do this. When I read stuff, I can pick up on the tone, the energy, the attitude, the everything. And if I hear you, baby, that's why I have to get off these phones. It's the worst. You can't just say, oh, I'm mad at the company, I'm sorry. No, ma'am. That went into every cell in my body. You know, and I have to try to sage and woosah and meditate and get it off. Like, no. I want to protect myself because of me, not because I'm putting myself in position to be verbally vomited on all day. Like, no, people are a lot. People have become too much for me. The next person says, we are all walking wounded. Some wounds still bleed, are still bleeding. Some are smothered in scar tissue. Some are evincing pain when we least expect it. And yet happiness, or its more common sibling, contentment, are within the reach of our wounded limbs. And I think that was beautiful. This person, to me, understands that there's so much chaos in this world, and they could live their whole life focusing on that, feeling worse and worse and worse and worse and worse, because that's such a low vibe. Or they can say, I acknowledge that that stuff exists, but let me go find the joy and happiness in life. Let me appreciate the contentment. Let me switch my point of view and maybe sprinkle a little bit more joy, a little bit more contentment to balance this thing out. That person has a beautiful insight on life. They didn't say that this stuff doesn't exist. They acknowledged it. They acknowledge it as both parts. Some people are still bleeding and some have scar tissue, meaning that they're attempting to heal or have healed. That's beautiful. So that person is I would say, is pretty balanced. The next person say, no, it's not true. We all have to go through difficult periods. We all have significant losses, but the majority of us do not go through traumatic events. A trauma is not a run-of-the-mill loss or a normal difficult event. It goes beyond the normal experience. Let's not normalize trauma so that people who have been traumatized are not lost in the we're all going through shit, get over it phenomenon. Now, that triggered me because when I took out FMLA, my boss was basically trying to tell me we all go through stuff, get over it. I don't think that's advice that anybody should give, because I could have took a whole bottle of pills. You just never know how strong someone is, and you don't know how what you say can affect people. Like, it's in the Bible. Life and death are in your tongue. Have y'all heard that some girl was convicted for telling her boyfriend to commit suicide, and he did? She's going to jail for that. Now, he did it himself. That's my first time hearing that. You commit suicide and someone else is going to jail for encouraging you. Didn't put a gun to your head, didn't give you rope, didn't help you hang yourself, didn't push you off the bed or not. Literally a text message. So the world is changing. I hope you guys realize that. That's why they're going so hard on us texting and tweeting and stuff like that, because there are real consequences behind it. This is very true. So be careful with what you say, because we know they're storing everything in clouds and shit. It's never going away. And, you know, it is what it is. And even with the passing of Kevin Samuels, he had a lot of good things to say. He just did not say them the right way. Women do need to prioritize their health. Women do need to be realistic. How do you want this guy to have A through Z and you barely got A? Like, I get what he was saying. He just didn't say it the right way. But let me tell you the difference between women looking at him. And me and my dad had this conversation. I say, I have you in my life. When I go through hard things, I can talk to you. And he's so calm and compassionate. He gives the best hugs. I don't know what I would do if I didn't have my dad in my life and my mom. But if I didn't have that dad figure there, I would go listen to. Let me see what this Kevin Samuels has to say, since my father isn't here. Let me hear what a father figure has to say. And that's not how you would talk to your daughter or your niece or your spouse. It was not. But then I heard an interview from his daughter, and he talked to her the same way. She felt like shit. And I'm like, wow. And it goes back to him being hurt. He constantly says how he would sit in the kitchen and listen to his mama, auntie, talk about men ain't shit. Now let's think about this for a minute. You're a young male. You're sitting at the table with women who you love, and they're saying men ain't shit. Well, excuse me. I raise my hand. I'm a man. So y'all saying I'm not shit? Like, you have to watch what you say. That affects people. And take accountability. The men that I'm coming in contact aren't crap. So let me take a step back, look in the mirror, do some soul searching, do some whatever, therapy, shadow work, trauma, healing. Because why am I picking no good men? It's a reflection of you. That's the hard truth that nobody want to talk about. I just realized that, like, oh, so we were trauma bonding. You didn't hurt me. We were just both hurting each other. Calling it love. It's just, I don't know. The more you learn, you just look at stuff differently. But let me go to the next person. Another person says yes. Maybe some more tragic than other people, but yeah, everyone has it. I have PTSD from being severely bullied, but it's gotten better. People were trying to make me go crazy, and some were trying to push me to commit suicide. Look at that confirmation, y'all. I'm stuck to this house, and Nick Kid is telling them to harass me and to make me go nuts and kill myself. How do I know that I have PTSD? How did I know that I had PTSD? I took a test, and they were checking to see if I had a disability or if I'm just being teased to the point where I can't focus. I don't care if you can focus. That's just unacceptable. See, this is why I'm not a parent yet. I'll be knocking on all the parents' doors. Excuse me, family meeting. Family meeting. It turned out that I have high blood pressure and that I needed to seek a therapist, and I did. She validated me that I have PTSD, and I still have the papers for the proof of being bullied. I remember being bullied. Me and my sister, we were cheerleaders, and this one girl was on the sorority team, and she did not like us. She was so mean. Her fat ass sister. And I just could not understand for the life of me, like, why did me and my sister have always been so tiny? Why were they messing with us? And I had never experienced that before. Like, I've always been nice. People have always liked me. And it was just like, why are you hating? So that was the only time. But it wasn't like, give me your lunch money, I'm going to give you a black eye. But it was like more verbal, like saying stuff. But we didn't have name brand stuff. And like, that's, you know, Bobo shoe, Bobo this, Bobo that, glasses. But still, like, who at home isn't loving you? Or who at home is picking on you and you are projecting that on other people? You see how you can look at that? I wasn't looking at it like that then. But yeah, the next person is saying, my guess is no. There might be people out there from really good families with really sheltered lives that don't have any trauma whatsoever. I don't agree with that, because if that's the case, let me tell you my point of view on that. Anytime I see a celebrity commit suicide, it's like, what the fuck? The fuck is wrong with you? You got all that money. You can get any nigga, any hoe. You can pay your house off. You can pay your mama house off. You can get a nanny, a maid. You can get a whole garden. Like, Oprah got a goddamn garden. You can hire a slave if you wanted to. Yes, they still have slaves overseas, but you don't see that on the news. And they are African, and they have chains and shackles. And some of them are women. And one lady said that her purchaser made her sleep in a goddamn shed. See, this is why I don't look at the news, because I had to see that on a goddamn social media on a YouTube. That wasn't on a damn news channel. So that's not the news to me. If you're not going to tell it all, that's not the news. You're going to keep it pretty and cute and lie, that's not the news. I don't want to see it. But anyways, something has to be wrong there. Out of all of that goodness, even, what was it, Miss America or something, jumped out a window. And then a part of me, this is 50-50, so a part of me is like, oh my gosh, what was that trauma? You know, they always say it's lonely at the top. You got all this money and you're alone. Like, and then 50, that's 50% of me. And then the other half is like, they tried to expose the government or something, and they pushed them out a window or something like that, because I'm just not going to pretend like this world is okay. Like, all of these movies with the government chasing people are made up. This shit is real. They have FBI and CIA. And raise your hand if you know what a CIA agent does. Raise your hand if you know what an FBI agent does. Raise your hand if you know what all the classified information is. It's classified for a reason. They got to cover their shit. Somebody gave them damn orders. But I remember I was working at Citibank, and was it Citibank? Converges. And one of my coworkers, her husband was an FBI agent, and he couldn't tell her what his job was. And he would go out on missions late at night and stuff, and she felt like he was cheating. Now, he could have been, but who? And that's probably why they wouldn't take me, because I would tell my whole family, like, look, pack your shit, we're going to Mexico. You got 2 months. I'll make sure my people know. Ain't no damn secret. My people gonna know. So yeah, I don't think that was nice to say. So I feel like she doesn't have a good life. She's envious and jealous of people that have had really good sheltered lives. Perhaps she wishes that was a life that she had. And instead of saying that, she speaks. Nothing's wrong with them. You know, you can just hear it and how people respond. Let me see. The next person says, this is the last one I'm going to do, by the way, because this one was really, really good. Everyone is traumatized, and I absolutely agree. We all perform well under normal circumstances. Poise stands out under pressure. When the heat is turned up, look for the teammate with the best coping skills to lead the way. That's not always the designated leader, excuse me. It's usually whoever has the most relevant experience with managing crisis effectively. Often it's the teammate with trauma history. Do you know anyone who has been through a traumatic event? Everyone is traumatized. It's not just survivors of abuse or violence would experience trauma. Perhaps you witnessed a bad car accident on the way home for a vacation. Perhaps you or someone you cared about recently experienced a sudden job loss. Maybe an unexpected turn of events stirred up a painful memory. Face it. Any significant change in our normal routine ignites an immediate need to adapt and employ a coping strategy. When we measure performance, whether in interpersonal, team, or organizational settings, we often assume purely normal circumstances support the platform upon which our actions are built. In most cases, however, the platform has a rickety infrastructure weakened by whatever current and past events are disrupting the norm. Those who dance effectively upon a shaky foundation are not trauma-free. They simply have acknowledged their challenges and factored them into the equation of their coping plans. Here's the last part. He also had an article here. The trauma of being alive. Trauma is not just a result of major disasters. It does not happen to only some people. An undercurrent of trauma runs through ordinary life. Shot through as it is with the poignancy of importance. I like to say that if we are not suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, we are suffering from pre-traumatic stress disorder. There is no way to be alive without being conscious of the potential for disaster. One way or another, death and its cousins, old age, illness, accident, separation, and loss hangs over all of us. Nobody is immune. Our world is unstable and unpredictable and operates to a great degree and despite incredible scientific advancement outside of our ability to control it. In resisting trauma and in defending ourselves from feeling its full effect, we deprive ourselves of its truth. That stood out to me. Because once I looked past the heartache and pain, I was able to see the truth. Oh, this connected to this connected to this. You just need to hug your inner girl. You just need to mother yourself. You know, it's just like, oh, but you have to get through it. That shit can take you out though. As a therapist, I can testify to how difficult it can be to acknowledge one's distress and to admit one's vulnerability. There is a rush to normal in many of us that closes us off not only to the depth of our own suffering, but also as a consequence to the suffering of others. While we are accustomed to thinking of trauma as the inevitable result of a major collateralism, daily life is filled with endless little traumas. I never thought of it that way. Things break. People hurt. Our feelings. Ticks carry Lyme disease. Pets die. Friends get sick and even die. The first day of school and the first day in a assisted living facility are remarkably similar. Separation and loss touch everyone. The willingness to face traumas, be they large, small, primitive, or fresh, is the key to healing from them. They may never disappear in the way that we think they should, but maybe they don't need to. Trauma is an ineradicable aspect of life. We are human as a result of it, not in spite of it. I knew she was a therapist. The way that she broke that down, she acknowledged every aspect of that. But most importantly, she mentioned that it shapes us. And there's so many ways that it could shape you. You could end up being a victim. You could end up being a hero. I think that's where the archetypes come from. Yeah. So I thought that was interesting. But if you want to read more, it just keeps going and going and going. But I wanted to stop there. I felt like those people had different points of view, amazing things to say. Okay, so let me shut that one down. Okay, the last thing I'm gonna do is my Pinterest, because it got some good quotes on there. But let's go over to trauma and see. Let me get in the shade. Ooh. I usually don't sweat, but ain't no breeze, baby. It's a little hot. It's a little hot. Y'all, I saw a big ass black snake. Now I'll just be looking at the ground. I was over there looking at that goddamn YouTube. The damn snake could have bit me. I didn't even know. And it was big. I saw a little snake before, but that one was so fucking big. Big ass black snake. And I'll just be looking down all the time. But I got the message, spirit. Thank you, Mother God. Okay. I wanted to go over these types of traumas. How many pages I got? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 pages, y'all. And I'm going to dig into them on my own, but I just wanted to list them and you guys could look into it for yourself. But I think I'm going to end up making, you know how people call them tarot cards? I'm going to just make learning cards. And I want to hand them down to my nieces and nephews and kids. And who knows what it'll turn into. But I got some index cards. And I wrote a lot of things on them. Because repetition is how I learn. And so until I see something like 100 times, I probably didn't learn it. But if I keep flipping with these cards, like, okay. I'm not going to need to wonder, okay, what does Mars mean? Okay, what is Venus? Okay, what is Aries? Like, I want it to be in me already. So I made my cards on different, every subject I come across now, I put them on my cards. They are on my OneNote. They are in my Pinterest, but it's like I'm pulling them out now. Ooh, look at that. It's coming from the internet world into the physical world. And then when I create them, they really will be in the physical world. I feel like that's how manifestations work too, but a lot of people are saying, okay, I might have to go in with these damn nets. A lot of people are saying that until you heal, you can't manifest like how you are supposed to, because there's holes in your aura field. There's, you know, you're not as strong as you're supposed to be. You're kind of weak. Your frequency, your vibration isn't as high. So healing is key. It all starts with you. And I feel like that's why a lot of shit has been going on, because we are so powerful. They had to traumatize us and break us down mentally, physically, emotionally, because they know it not only affects us, but it's going in our DNA and it's going to affect 3, 4, 5 generations. Like, how powerful are we that somebody has to attack us on that many fields? So the moment we wake up and recognize this bullshit and start with ourselves and share with others, that we all will heal and then we could really make a change. So it's a self journey, but since we all are one, now I get why they say all is one, because when you heal yourself, you heal others, because we're all one. Or what affects one affects the other. So anyway, types of trauma. Multi-generational trauma. It's also called generational or intergenerational or transgenerational. And that's another thing. They give these things so many names. Bitch, the trauma from great-grandma to mama came to you. But they have to give it so many. And it says it takes 3 generations to heal. So my spiritual advisor had told me that I was selected. I think Pluto comes every 200 whatever years. And I was selected out of my family to heal. And I'm like, well, bitch, it feel like I'm getting the most trauma. I'm single. I don't have no family. I don't have no kids. Like, I'm going through all of this stuff. But it's because I get it now. It's like, heal. and then we'll let you start the next generation, because if you don't heal, it's going to keep going on. So I get it. Now, I get it, but I'm still dealing with these emotions and stuff, but I get it. I get it. And I didn't know when you become pregnant, the mentality that you have, the emotions that you have, that all is creates that baby. So the best being that you are is the best being that you're going to have. The worst off you are, you just brought more of that into the world. I hate to say it, but it's true, because look at us all. If you sit us all down, there's childhood trauma. That's proof. That's fucking proof. It's one girl, I look at her YouTube, XO, Michaela. She was explaining the trauma that she had with her mom. And I just felt so sad, because everybody that I know has such a good bond with their mom. And even though I bump hands with my mom, she would probably catch a body for me, and I know I would too. As much as she don't like jail, I'm pretty sure she would. But because even though we bump heads, at the end of the day, that's mine. You're not going to touch that one. Not that one. And my best friend always reminds me how blessed I am, because she lost her mom in seventh grade. And I think I take it for granted sometimes. Because if you're not without, how do you understand the experience of being without? But I feel for them, because I have. It's like, oh my gosh. Your mom teaches you about things. Your dad can't teach you how to handle a damn baby, about how to breathe and how to push, and you know, just different things that women go through. Your mom, you don't want to hear that from your auntie, your sister, your brother. You want to hear that from your mom. So my heart just went out to her. And that's just what she chose on this path to heal from. And she'll be able to heal so many people. But until you get to that healing part, it's like a shit show. So they broke the generations down. The first is afflicted by the pain. It reminds me of slavery. The second gets into recovery. It reminds me of my grandma and my parents. They weren't slaves anymore. They were able to work and get government assistance and provide for their families. And then the third generation is spared. And I agree with that. So it moves from affliction to healing to release. Trauma is experienced from one generation to the next. So, if we want to be honest, all African-American people should get 12 weeks of FMLA. You want to know why? That's trauma. So, I think instead of giving us 40 acres and a mule, they give us 12 weeks of FMLA, and they figure if you don't take it, oh, well. I think I just put that together. Because if you could do that every year and there's nothing to do about it, if you work for a company for 30 years, if you timed that by 12 weeks of FMLA, that probably would be that 40 acres and a mule. So are they not paying 40 acres and a mule, or are we not taking advantage of what they are offering? And I challenge you, look up FMLA. Look up the requirements for your job. Look at the hours. I think you have to work 12 weeks, reach so many hours. No, I think you have to work so many hours, and then you're eligible for FMLA. And you can do it, like, you can say, I want to be off 2 weeks, 2 days out of the week. You could do it every month. You could just do it straight, your full 2 months. And I wish I wasn't at such odds with my job, because I would just do FMLA every year. But I don't even want to be employed by them. It's not about the money. It's about the company. I don't want to work for them. I don't want to work for the ops. But anyways, another trauma is pregnancy and birth. I knew about losing a child. Like, I understand that trauma. I understand a miscarriage. I understand ectopic pregnancy. I understand giving birth, stillbirth. I understand even having a young child and using them. My grandma even lost a daughter, so a loss is a loss. But my mom was explaining the fact being pregnant itself is traumatic. Your boobs change, your stomach change, you know, the baby wants to eat certain things. I just thought of this, yo, what if my baby want meat and I'm pregnant? Oh, we gonna be fighting. Oh, we gonna be fighting, because we not gonna put them cloned as old as meat that they redip in blood and sell, probably human meat. No, me and my baby gonna be fighting. Like, you better eat this smoothie, eat this banana, and chill. Or I'm gonna be like, you're evicted. You have 2 more months and you're out. It's gonna be so funny to see me pregnant because I'm impatient and I'm gonna have to chill for 9 fucking months. Can you imagine an impatient person pregnant? I want to see that. I'm gonna look up impatient pregnant women and see how they're experiencing this thing called life. Not life, pregnancy. Okay, so it says stress of them during the pregnancy disrupting the mother's ability to bond. I even heard, like, when a woman has a child and it's not what she thought it would be, that's trauma, because she has to accept the child for who they are and not what she hoped they'd be. But that leads back to unrealistic expectations. Like, why do we want to control everything? We want to control so much and get mad when we can't. Like, no. Because if you get to control how someone acts, they get to control you. And I know you don't want nobody to control you, so just accept the fact that you aren't controlling them. It goes both ways. I deal with that too, though. Trauma in childhood. This is a long-ass list, y'all. This is what gets a lot of us. Now, if any of this affects you, you have trauma, you've been traumatized. Ready, set, go. Adverse childhood experiences. Experience physical abuse. Sit your ass down. Emotional abuse. So far, I got 2. Abandonment, 3. And there's different degrees. Like, abuse could be, like, I beat my niece for the first time and I feel so bad. Like, next time I see her, I'm gonna say, I'm so sorry for beating you. But you don't scream like that. Like, they like to look at women having babies on YouTube, and the mom and dad doesn't want them to see that. So every time I come over, I have my phone, I have my iPad, they look at it, I'm getting in trouble. I'm the one mom and dad is looking at. Like, we told them they can't see that. And it's like, so the sisters told me she was looking at it and I told her to turn it off. She went in her room and screamed. I'm trying to think. If you've ever seen the movie The Little Princess, when the girl is just screaming and kicking and screaming and kicking. And I'm like, girl, hush. And it's like she got louder and I spanked her a little bit. But now I'm going to apologize, and she should have been able to express herself however she wanted, because the fact is she's not going to look at no woman push a baby out. Not because of me, I don't care, but because her parents don't want her to. And that's messing up the ability of me getting them or them trusting me with them and all that stuff. So I could have expressed it differently, but I was just like, what are you screaming for? So I have to apologize for her, because I don't want her to be traumatized by that. One time Auntie Boo beat me. But physical abuse could be a pop on the hand. It could be a no-no. It could be, sometimes my dad was so strict, he could be like, no, come here. And it would just make you cry. It doesn't have to be abuse. It could be energy too. And then abandonment. I actually lived with someone else at a young age. I moved in with my boyfriend at a young age. And it was just so much. I have so much to unpack. But abandonment could be, I saw, like, one woman, she was an executive and she had to work all the time. And her daughter was saying, I want you to cook dinner. I want you to put me in bed. But she had to work and her dad had to do it. So that was her feeling abandoned. Not that her mom wasn't there and she was living with someone else, but the simple fact that when she needed her mom, she wasn't there as a little girl. So I'm going to keep going, but I'm pretty sure I got a check mark on a lot of these stuff. Neglect, losing a family member, suicide victims, substance abuse, mentally ill parent, an incarcerated parent, divorce or separation, a low-income family, low level of education, high level of family stress, economic stress, not so close-knit family, spankings as a punishment, abused parents, neglected parents, high rates of violence, economically disadvantaged community, high level of substance abuse, few resources for any youth, difficulty forming close relationships, trouble keeping jobs, difficulty with friends and difficulty with finances, depression, more involved in violence, unwanted pregnancies, more likely to be incarcerated, high levels of unemployment, more likely to expose children to adverse childhood experiences, having high risk of alcohol and substance abuse, higher risk of suicide attempts, have high risk of health issues, heart disease, cancer, lung disease, liver disease, parent and child relationship traumas. Traumas and triggers can offset chronic illnesses. So do you see where this is going? This is going from a traumatic event to an actual physical illness. So it goes from the act being done, having a traumatic emotional effect on your mind, manifesting into your body, and then you just trying to heal one aspect. No, baby, that's a lot to heal. You got to heal all them layers. Emotional trauma. They call acute trauma if it's physical, emotional, sexual. It could be war-related, natural disasters, illnesses, death of a loved one, a breakup. I did not know that. Leaving the community, getting fired or laid off, being betrayed. I didn't know that. A chronic trauma is what they call a small or small negative event that builds up over time that creates a macro trauma, such as eating disorder and bullying. Did not think of that. So that's usually me. Shit build up and then I explode. So it's like I take it and then I can't take it anymore. But just imagine when it finally explodes, now you have a million pieces to heal when it could have been just one, healing one piece at a time. Trauma bonding. I did not know that was a thing. Trauma healing. That needs to be my next. I kept looking up like, what is that noise? Bitch. Oh, it's not. Oh my God. See, that's why I need to have my damn glasses on. But I keep hearing something over there. And I keep looking up. Trauma healing. I did not know that was a thing. So I want to look into that. Trauma healing. So I'm not even going to read that because that's on the next page. Let's keep talking about trauma. Neglect, infidelity. And some of these are repeating because I'm just going through different sources and writing them all down. Neglect, infidelity, emotional abuse, bullying, infertility, burnout, unemployed, immigrating, abandonment trauma, complex trauma, system-induced trauma, interpersonal trauma, impersonal trauma, literacy, identity, community, loved ones with a severe illness, oppression, non-consensual sexual encounters, divorce, partner, struggling with an addiction, violence, abuse from authority, undiagnosed health challenges, poverty, chronic pain. Chronic pain, multiple losses in a row. That's a lot, y'all. That is a fucking lot. How many could you count? That would be dope. I can put that in like a little test format and say like put a check here and do you suffer with trauma? Don't think so. Check each one that applies to you. You have been affected by trauma. I like to learn and I like to turn that learning into some type of form of creation. But I'm learning that there's different ways to create. See, there you go again. So the more I, the more I learn, I'll be able to, the more avenues of creativity or creation I learn, I'll be able to see which one I like and create. Oh, her roses, her flowers are going away too. Y'all, we got about 2 more months of spring and that's it. May, June, July, August, yup. This year went by fucking fast. It's going to be fucking December, y'all. I might have my car paid off the end of this month. So excited. Thank you, Jesus. If I would have did overtime, it would have been done. But bitch can barely get through her 8 hours. You know that's bad. I be like, am I going in today? hell no. So I want to find a job like my best friend. She don't have to be on the phone. She like key and stuff. And she get to listen to her music and podcasts and stuff. So I hope I can find a job like that. And I just reached out to the realtor broker to see if I can get my foot in the game. But somebody already said that it's really bad realtor's market right now, especially for newbies. And you have to pay your desk fees and stuff like that. I ain't trying to be racking up all of these fees when we ain't making no commission money. So I'm gonna wait for her to write back and see where that takes me. Then I was thinking about leasing apartments and stuff, but I don't want to be dealing with people, and them people be nasty too, like, come fix my toilet. Yeah, I don't know. I remember I was a night shift manager at the hotel, and it was a fire, and I was just so fucking scared. I had to look through the book and try to figure out what to do. I don't want that kind of responsibility. I feel like being a leasing agent is like that too. Like, if my manager ain't there, that shit gonna follow me with this damn house. Bitch, we just need to know if you got approved for that damn loan. Do you got a credit score? Get approved for this loan. What kind of house you want? Send you over to the notary to sign them damn papers and get my commission. It's just like less of the bullshit. Yeah, that's the type of job I want. No bullshit, all the bullshit. But let me go over my let me go over the Pinterest. Let me see how long this one is. Ooh, very long. All right, so this is gonna be a two-part podcast basically, and the next, or part two, is gonna be on my trauma Pinterest. So I will catch you guys on the next episode. Thank you for listening to me ramble. Thank you for holding space for me to therapeutically talk and podcast and learn and share my growth and development and trauma and problems, because that's what they are. I really do appreciate it. I hope you were able to learn something from this podcast, and I will catch you guys on the next episode. Bye. It's 7.9 billion people in this world, yet you met me. And that is not by happen chance. It's a divine meeting, and may we guide each other well. If life is a school, what lesson did you learn today? What class did you take today? Did you pass or fail your test or pop quiz? If so, it's okay. Failing allows you to restudy an area that you're weak in, so you can try again better than before and pass with 100%. Keep learning, evolving, and spreading love, and I hope you see the fruits of your labor. Namaste, levaste, and always vibe high, babe. Thanks a million for listening. I hope you have a better than great day. Love you. Talk to you later. Mwah. Bye.